This is my first time at playing Life is Beautiful Festival. I have no idea what to expect, but I'm very excited. I've just played a pool party for 30 minutes, so it's super quick, but it got me in the vibe, and now I'm gonna get some tunes ready and head over to Life is Beautiful. Playing festivals for me are generally like a great outlet for meeting all different people from different walks of life, different cultures, different countries. It's like the thing that festivals offer is just this wide range of a mix of people. I love clubs also, but I play very differently to how I'd play at a festival. With the festivals, I kind of prepare for going on different journeys, whereas in a club, I'm kind of like more focused on that kind of one specific thing and taking it a bit deeper in the clubs. 100%, every country I go to is different. I think essentially, you know, once you get to a point like where I'm at now, people go there to see you and they want to hear your songs. And then you start to find that if your sets are only an hour long or an hour and a half, the more music you make starts taking up the majority of that set. So it's about being creative. I very rarely play the original versions of my songs now. I kind of take the acapellas and make these mad mashups and just create something new and just to keep the sets fresh and exciting all the time. But yeah, they do change. You know, like I head to Miami tomorrow and my set would be very different to what I play at Life is Beautiful. So Younger came about with me kind of wanting to work with HRVY and the same him wanting to work with me for quite a while. We actually met a couple of years ago at a radio show called Summertime Ball, and HRVY at that point had been performing a couple of my songs in his sets and really wanted to work with me. I then brought him out on stage to perform these songs with me, so I think it was like Mama, Rise, Polaroid. And the crowd went crazy, and then we kind of got this reaction from both our fan bases, which was like, why aren't you two doing a song? That then led me to the point of, right, it's now time to work on a song. Now, HRVY wanted to do something like Mama, which I didn't want to do. I wanted to kind of do and create a lyric, which was a kind of a little bit deeper. And I'd been inspired by songs like Lucas Graham, 7 Years, Adele, When We Were Young, and that whole idea of kind of, you know, an age and being nostalgic. However, those songs are a little bit sad, and my music is always kind of this, you know, super positive, happy summer vibes. So I kind of took that inspiration, put a flip on it, and came up with the idea of Younger. And it just felt like the perfect song for me and HRVY to do. My dream collaborator right now would be Shawn Mendes. I've met Shawn a few times and we've spoken about the idea of doing a collaboration, but hopefully at some point when our schedules allow, we can get in the studio and vibe something out. Generally with a lot of the people that sing my songs, I usually write the songs with a couple of my collaborators first, and then I find the artist that can feature on the song with me. However, Perfect Strangers was completely different. It was a song that me and JP wrote together. JP's an incredible songwriter. We actually wrote Polaroid together for Liam Payne and Lennon Stella. It's kind of a little bit of a mixture, but generally I write the songs with a couple of my collaborators first, and then we go from there. I'm always on the hunt for new talent. I mean, it kind of started out as a thing where, you know, everyone wanted to collaborate with the biggest and best artists, which I 100% love doing and want to do and et cetera, et cetera. However, in the very start, when I had songs like Fast Car, I couldn't get anyone to sing my songs. So it became a thing where I'd find this new talent, nurture them, and then they go on to do these amazing things. You know, people like JP Cooper, Ray, William Singe, you know, they go on to do the most amazing things. So there's something about finding new talent and not only giving people a new song when I release something new, but giving them a new artist. So it's become a thing, and you know, now having my publishing company and my record label, it makes even more sense to find new artists that I can develop. It's always something that I've wanted to do at some point, and it's at the minute it's kind of starting very slow, and it's about finding the right artist. I found an incredible artist from LA called Dark Heart, who's a producer, songwriter, and he's incredible. But it was, yeah, mainly to, you know, find this new talent. And what I ended up finding was a lot of the talent that I'd brought onto my records struggled afterwards. They didn't, you know, they'd have these massive moments with me, with these huge songs that would go global, and then wouldn't have a clue what to do, you know. And it's my background and my understanding and being in this industry for a long time has enabled me to, you know, find the paths for not only myself but for other people to you know, navigate, essentially. So that was the reason to create the label. I learned music production. Originally it was a CD that I got free in a cereal box, a program called EJ. And I started on that when I was like 11 or 12 years old. Did that every single day when I came home from school. My PC Packard Bell computer, it was like, it was the best thing ever. So I've literally been doing it every single day since then. You know, from EJ, I then went on to other doors, you know, Cubase, Logic, Fruit Loops, FL Studio it's now called, Ableton. You know, I was a bit of a computer geek, and I wanted to learn about all the programs. So it kind of went from there, really, you know, just being this sponge and wanting to learn about what all these music production pieces of software can offer me. And yeah, I just did it every day. I'm still doing it every day. This all started for me when I was like 11 years old. Back then, there used to be a TV program about Ibiza on Channel 4 called Club Reps. And that, for me, was the insight, essentially, into the club world. You know, I'd sit in my living room imagining I was in a club in Ibiza, having the TV up super loud, and essentially wait until the end credits would come up so that I could learn what songs were in that program at that time. And that's how I got into the kind of club world. And then, yeah, when I was like 14, 15, I started playing clubs locally, bars, and it went from there, really. Just before I became Jonas Blue, I was working in the city of London in a bar, DJing, and Sam Smith worked at the same bar. I had no idea he was a singer. No one told me at the bar that he was a singer, and no one told him that I was a music producer. So we both just were kind of workers at this bar. He then went on to do the single with Disclosure, which was Latch. I think he had his EP out at that time as well. And then I went on to do Fast Car, and yeah, crazy, but we're actually signed to the same record label in the US, and we still haven't met since the bar. But it was very brief, and I love his music so much. So with Fast Car, originally it was my mum's favourite song when I was a baby, and I was born in 89, that song came out originally in 88. It was a massive, massive record in the UK, and it would always be on the radio. So I always just remember being on these car journeys and it coming on, you know, that very kind of soulful guitar, and it's very stripped back, and it was just like, when I was a kid, I had no idea what was going on. It was just, you know, this is the Fast Car song. But it stuck with me as just one of them all-time classics. And when I grew up, I started to work in record shops, and people would make versions of it that were absolutely terrible because they would just speed up the original and put some house beats behind it or whatever else. And it was never quite how I imagined it should be done. And it was always one of those in the back of my mind that someday it would be great to do that song. And then I had a moment in 2015 where kind of like my life changed, music changed for me. I went to Ibiza for the first time, and I met Scooter Braun. I was at a club called Ushuaia. And there was just many moments throughout that holiday that inspired me, and having this kind of little idea, light bulb thing at the back of my head, that Fast Car could be a cool song. I then went back home, and I did it in like one evening, Fast Car, and it then just went on to become this massive thing. There's a couple of songs that I would love to reimagine, but it would be very bad if I told you guys what it was right now. But I did one. I did one actually, which was Died in Your Arms, Cutting Crew, which was more of like a club thing, and I play it in pretty much every one of my sets. And that was a fun one to do. That was after watching Hot Tub Time Machine. It's in there, and I was inspired by that and wanted to make a club record out of it. So one of my idols is a guy named Max Martin, and he said this one thing that people, it stems from his mentor, which was a guy named Dennis Pop, that people shouldn't, and this was back in the late 80s, within the first 7 seconds, people should know your song. Now that has always stuck with me, and now being in the streaming revolution that we're in, it's even more relevant now. That's one of the key things to my songs. As soon as you hit play, you know what it is. Then the rest of the song, it's not about complicating the songs, it's about keeping things simple, but they are the hardest ones to create because the simplest songs are, you know, you're trying to create something that no one's ever heard before, but in a very simplistic way. I'm very lucky that I get to play clubs and festivals, so I write songs tailored to that. I don't know what it is that makes the perfect pop song. I think just catchy melodies and taking people on a journey through the verses and the pre-choruses when it gets to the chorus. Exactly, why make an album? I did an album and it was a lot of fun to do. However, I think the world that I'm in and what my fans want is music just all the time, instantly. Now, I think if you're Adele or you're Sam Smith, you can take a year out and make an album. If I take a year out, the musical genres that are influenced within my scene have changed. So for me, it's important to do more singles and EPs. And that way I can, you know, if I travel to South America and I'm influenced by a favela funk or something like that, that's the craze at the time, I can put that out straight away. I haven't got to wait a year. So for me, it's more interesting to be able to be inspired and put it out right away. I think, you know, albums are cool when they allow you to say something can take people on more of a journey, for sure. But I'm more excited about singles and the instant gratification that you get from people just listening to that single or the EP, so. I listen to a lot of Backstreet Boys, I listen to a lot of Britney, and I listen to a lot of NSYNC. It's true. I listen to a lot of this stuff and I listen to it over and over again. And the mad thing is, a lot of my songs have the same arrangements to Backstreet Boys songs or NSYNC songs that Max Martin produced. That's why. I mean, it's a thing. It's a thing, and it's still going. It's cool. I have friends that are on there. I enjoyed it in the start, probably like the first season, and then yeah, it's cool. 2020 for me, I started up another label as well, which is my label called Electronic Nature, and that's basically an outlet for club music. Because I had at one point a lot of people saying to me, "Oh, you know, you're the Spotify guy. You're the guy that makes the radio hits and stuff like that. You know, you're not the guy that makes all the club stuff." And I was like, "I come from that world, but I'm just not doing it as much. You know, I was doing it on my remixes, but not my original music." So Electronic Nature is an outlet for me to, you know, collaborate with new upcoming DJs and established DJs and producers, as well as just singles by myself. And I'm going to be doing a lot more of that in 2020, as well as obviously all the usual singles that I put out. But really ramping that up, Electronic Nature, getting the events going, getting the record label going, finding new producers. I'm going to be over in the US a lot more next year, which will be fun. And what else am I working on next year? A lot of touring. The usual stuff, but bigger and better because it's 2020. If I won a huge jackpot here in Vegas, what would I do? What would I do? This is a hard one. What would I do? I'd buy a nightclub. if I was here? Yeah, that'd be my thing. I'd buy a nightclub and rule Vegas.